We appreciate your joining us, and we appreciate our friends from MetroEast Community Media for filming the conversation, the Q&A, and something that's available for people in the community to look at. Because I think this is a topic that is worthy of consideration by everybody in the community. Some of you know I spend a lot of time working on infrastructure, bicycles, light rail, streetcar. I've done a lot of work on sewer and water over the years. But people do not appreciate how fundamental the infrastructure is for the United States Postal Service. And I've been wanting to have this conversation here for the broader community for a long time. I've made some of these remarks on the floor of the House because I've been deeply concerned that there is not proper appreciation for what it means to this country to have the finest postal service in the world. About half of the volume around the world is handled by the United States Postal Service. It was mandated by the Constitution, and in fact, those postal roads that are there, part of the federal government being involved there as well. The first postmaster, Ben Franklin. You don't get more iconic than that. And it made a huge difference for the development of our emerging democracy, sharing information, the development of commerce. And the Postal Service has been involved with other infrastructure. Railroads was an early mechanism to deliver postal service around the country. It's why we still have the main post office across the street from our main train station, Union Station here. The Postal Service was part of the emergence of aviation, contracting early on for the delivery of mail through the air. I'm of the opinion that we ought to be looking at ways to innovate going forward with the circumstances today with that network. The post office ties people together. It is universal service. You may think about it. For less than two quarters, you can drop something in the mail in Portland, Oregon, and be confident that it's going to be delivered in Portland, Maine. It used to be a day or two later. It's still very reliable, despite, I think, the attacks on the Postal Service. It's an amazing bargain. It is an opportunity for people without an address to pick up mail, where you can access stamps and services, tax forms, sometimes passports. It's an opportunity, and we get story after story after story of how the people who work for the Postal Service connect with the people they serve. It is routinely at the top of the list in terms of the public appreciation for a government service. People respect it. Now, I'm saying this with a tiny bit of a bias because three of my kids' grandparents had worked in the Postal Service, two of them all the way through retirement. And the stories of what my father-in-law, during the holiday season, getting expressions, cookies and things you can drink from his customers, and watching their dedication for year after year after year to the Postal Service. So I've had a chance to see it up close. And they were able to raise their children. They were able to have a secure retirement. Things that Americans used to take for granted, and today is increasingly a challenge. It is my hope that in the course of the conversation here, we'll have a chance to lay out some of these facts and statistics, looking at some of the challenges. We've got some experts here to help round it out. And then my thought is that we just turn it into an opportunity for people to make comments, ask questions of the experts, and think about where we're going forward. The post office has a challenge because, frankly, Congress has been schizophrenic. It has been a quasi-government agency since the Nixon administration, not having public subsidy. It's been self-supporting. It is, and we'll talk maybe a little bit more about that, it is largely self-supporting and would be, except for a bizarre decision, singling out the United States Post Office as the only entity in the federal government, and to the best of my knowledge, nobody in the private sector is required to pre-fund half a century of health care obligations and do so only over 10 years out of the operating budget of today. Now think about that. What would happen if the Department of Defense, which actually has more generous benefits, had been required to fund the next 50 years of their retirees' health care out of the existing budget? It would be decimated. And it would also be crazy, because it is unnecessary. Nobody is arguing that we don't want to be fiscally prudent. And there have been changes that we can talk about dealing with the universe in which the Postal Service operates. I've been in Congress 20 years, and I have found, without exception, the men and women who represent the various postal organizations have been willing to be partners. They have, in the course of their contract negotiations and working on policy with the Postal Service, willing to make adjustments. Their employees have made changes, and I would argue some sacrifices. It's not somehow that they're intransigent or not willing to think about what should happen going forward. But Congress wants the post office to operate like a business, it is told, even though it subjects Congress, subjects the Postal Service to a requirement that no business is subjected to. And Congress, even though it wants it to operate like a business, be independent, not have any taxpayer support, Congress really just can't quite let go. What are we looking at now in terms of a reduction in the cost of a first-class postage stamp? Why? Well, Congress retains that control. So they want it both ways. They don't want the responsibility. They don't want to be investing. They want to claim that they're reducing postal employees, greater efficiency. But they won't give the Postal Service the flexibility to be able to look at a range of services and opportunities. And we're going to hear more of this in a moment from our panelists. But I'm personally of the opinion that the mail ballot that we have in Oregon is something that should actually be expanded nationally. National vote by mail would save the taxpayers huge sums of money. It's cheaper for Oregon to administer our elections via mail. But that's not the major reason. Some of us are old enough to remember hanging Chad in Florida. Concerns about failures at polling places, manipulation, sadly, we've seen by both parties, although I would be prepared to argue my Republican friends have refined it to an art form. But nobody should be able to manipulate the election process. Having a universal vote by mail would eliminate voter fraud, which isn't that big of a problem now, as we know. But here in Oregon, we check every single ballot to the signature. There's no question. And you don't have to worry about something disappearing from a machine. There is a record. And voters have a voting day that's 440 hours long, so that there's the time to reflect and follow through. And you don't have to worry about a voting machine that breaks, or a long line at a polling place, or somebody trying to intimidate somebody else, or voter fraud. Why wouldn't we make it a national priority to expand that, to provide printed postage envelopes to protect the integrity of the ballot box? I think it is a no-brainer. Why are we not looking at opportunities to be able to have these outposts provide a wider array of services? Why aren't we a full-service passport opportunity? The demand for passports is going up and up and up, and we may hear a little more in detail from the experts here. I'm getting a little carried away, but I feel very strongly about this, that we really have not done our job in Congress. We're down now, I think, to having a postal board of governor. But we're down to one who's been confirmed. Now, the administration has nominated people. I don't know how much of a priority. It's hard, I know, for President Obama to sometimes get cooperation from the Senate. And we've seen some real foot dragging over the course of the last 7.5 years. But it's shameful that we don't have a full complement of men and women on the Board of Governors. And it's, for me, it's a symbol of neglect and just kind of sweeping it under the rug. There are any number of other things that could be done. I'm old enough to remember when there was a postal savings account where we have over 30,000 facilities across the country that could provide a low-cost, convenient mechanism for people to save. We've got millions of Americans who simply don't have bank accounts, and I can't imagine why anybody who watches the headlines today would have any question about whether or not they want to entrust their resources to a bank. Having this as a low-cost, universal service, like they have in other countries, could provide benefits to the public and, again, be able to absorb costs to be able to make sure that it all works. Last but not least, the post office has been the heart and soul of rural and small-town America. The post office on Main Street is sort of an iconic location where people gather and they get those tax forms. They have a chance to interact. It is a source of pride and identity. And actually, there are still hundreds of post offices that are architectural jewels that add value in terms of the community identity. And those over 30,000 locations still are important for communities. But I mentioned the rural and small town America because economic opportunity that provides family wage jobs that provides decent benefits and a secure retirement in places where those jobs often are in scarce supply, particularly if they are people who have a variety of skills, that they don't have to be a wildlife biologist. I mean, real people can get real jobs and provide real service. I've often wondered what the overall economic impact is for the Postal Service. It would be ranked among the largest global companies. But what is that economic impact for communities that are on the edge? And you're going to hear from some of our experts here that some of the proposals that have been floated as cost-cutting, which really aren't really necessary for the post office to be able to be in the black, would actually isolate them more, cut them off. And as the integrity of the Postal Service frays, it puts those communities more at risk. Because there will always be somebody in the private sector that's willing to deliver in my zip code or in downtown Portland. And that competition is healthy. And there's some interesting partnerships that takes place with the private sector that can be elaborated on here. But providing universal service for that less than half a dollar, that's not going to survive if we end up cannibalizing the service or if we just farm that out to the highest bidder. That is a public good. That is something that has been guaranteed to this point by that constitutional provision. And I think it's something we should not take lightly. So I deeply appreciate your willingness to be part of a conversation with us this afternoon. I appreciate our experts being here who can speak in much greater detail than I and with greater authority. I do appreciate that we've got MetroEast community media so that our conversation can be available to other people in the community. This matters. It is an infrastructure resource that's every bit as important as the interstate freeway system and broadband connections. It is something that has been developed over 230 years, and it's something that ought to be taken advantage of, not undermined. So I am looking forward to shifting into the conversations from here. I'd like to turn first to Jim Sauber, who's the chief of staff for the letter carriers. He's been with them over 30 years, an economist by training, and we won't hold that against him. He's chairman of the Employee Thrift Advisory Council to the federal board that serves the Thrift Savings Plan. He is one of a very large family, 14 children. Growing up in Detroit in a, not coincidentally, maybe a union family. I really appreciate him being here from the national level to give some perspective about the challenges we face, where we're going, and thoughts about how we go forward. Jim, the podium is yours.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, thanks to the Congressman for the invitation. This is one of my favorite cities in the country. We have a tremendous local branch here, Branch 82. And I have to say, and I wouldn't say this in many states in the country, it's hard to beat a congressional delegation than the one you have in Oregon and when it comes to fighting for the Postal Service. So I'm really appreciative to be here. I want to just touch on two topics in my time, and then I'm sure we'll be able to answer your questions. One is, I just want to underline something that Congressman Blumenauer said, just how important the Postal Service is to this country's economy. I think in the popular imagination, they think, well, the Postal Service used to be important. You know, there was a time when most people paid their bills through the mail, and mail was used in a different way than it's being used today. But one of the things about the internet is, while it is true that people are paying more and more of their bills online, the internet is creating all sorts of new uses of the mail, and there's no reason to believe that's not going to continue. So for example, a huge percentage of the prescription drugs for sort of maintenance drugs in this country are delivered through the mail. Not only is it a more efficient way to distribute drugs, it's also a way to improve health. People who get their drugs renewed automatically through the mail use them more consistently, and their health improves. We've become, just to give you some numbers, Postal Service is the hub of a $1.4 trillion mailing industry. And when you think about all the things that feed into the mailing industry, paper, printing, packaging, e-commerce, advertising, there's just newspapers, magazines. It's an enormous industry that relies on the Postal Service. And those industries provide 7.5 million jobs to American families. Only about 500,000 of those are postal jobs. The rest of them are in the private sector. So it's very important to remember that what Congressman Blumenauer said about this being an essential part of the nation's economic infrastructure, that's really true. And it's not just an old-fashioned thing. Companies like eBay and Amazon, which are sort of the definition of the modern e-commerce economy, those companies are hugely dependent on the Postal Service. Companies like FedEx and UPS increasingly use the Postal Service for last-mile delivery. We're integrated to a great degree, and it's very important for the country, and not just for rural Americans, but also for urban Americans. And I cannot agree more with what the Congressman said about looking at this national infrastructure network as a sort of national treasure that could be used and expanded in all sorts of new ways. Vote My Mail and postal banking and the things that he mentioned. Now, I'm with the National Association of Letter Carriers. It's one of four employee union organizations, and the unions have been working together and building bridges with all the companies that make up our industry. And we've been trying for a good 10 years to address this pre-funding problem. As Congressman Blumenauer said, this is the thing that's defined the Postal Service's finances over the last 10 years. The Postal Service has reported in excess of $55 billion in losses over the last 10 years. About 90% of those losses stem from the pre-funding. We've been recovering from the Great Recession, and in fact, over the last 4 years, without the pre-funding burden, we would have earned profits of $4.5 billion. There's an e-commerce boom on now, and a general recovery in direct mail that has, in the absence of this really unique and burdensome congressional mandate, the Postal Service would be thriving. So we've been working to build a larger coalition with companies like Pitney Bowes and Amazon and State Farm and Capital One, people who belong to different coalitions of trade associations, to try to find a way to find a common ground on ways to approach fixing the pre-funding burden. We've tried many, many different ideas, but we've had some real success in building consensus around a set of proposals that actually, many of which were included in a bill that actually passed our Congressional Oversight Committee in the House earlier this year. The bill's got lots of problems and things that we can talk about in the Q&A period. But in general, there's a consensus emerging within the postal industry, which includes the labor, to focus in on reducing the cost of pre-funding retiree health by more fully integrating with the Medicare program, which, after all, the Postal Service and its employees have paid $40 billion in taxes over the last 30 years for the Medicare program. So using it to its utmost is certainly a way to reduce the cost of retiree health insurance. We've also have a proposal to better invest our retiree health fund. Right now, we invest solely in treasury bonds for a fund that really pays out over 90 years. And that's not really a sensible way. We've been only earning 2 or 3% on our retiree health fund. If we invested in the thrift savings plan type investment funds, which are low-cost index funds, very broad-based, just in overall stocks and bonds and the economy. If we had done that since the beginning, we'd have earned 6 or 7%. So that would also reduce the burden of pre-funding. We've got a, there's large-scale agreement about using the, giving the Postal Service the right to ship beer and wine and other new kinds of products through the mail. And we also have, you know, other kinds of ideas that we'd like to explore in that context, you know, improving, you know, expanding vote by mail, extending the use of our retail network, which is just in, you know, an absolute national resource to provide other government services and hopefully eventually help solve the problem of financial exclusion in the country. There are 68 million Americans who live in households without access to banks. What that means is that they end up relying on this alternative banking system or financial system, shadow system out there that's not very fair for particularly working class and poor people. You know, they rely on payday lenders and pawn shops and things like that because they don't have access to low-cost savings options. So that's a new use for our network. And then finally, there's actually an agreement in the mailing industry to adjust rates upward. As the Congressman mentioned, recently the Postal Service cut the postage rate across the country at a time when they have this huge financial burden. That was done based on an order from our regulator, the Postal Regulatory Commission, and the mailing industry this is not universally supported, but there is an agreement to partially restore the increase of postage stamps slightly by 2.15%. So those are the ideas that there's consensus around. I think there's going to be an attempt during the lame duck session to see if there's a chance to move that forward. There's still some problems with the legislation. There's really an unnecessary attack on door-to-door delivery, which really doesn't make business sense in the age of e-commerce and is really discriminatory towards the elderly and disabled folks who really value that door-to-door delivery service. Going forward, we should be increasing the amount of door delivery, not decreasing it. There's also some problems with making sure that the Medicare integration doesn't disadvantage truly vulnerable seniors who have limited resources to comply with increased participation in Medicare. So we're working on those issues. Thanks to members of Congress like Congressman Blumenauer, I think we have a real chance, if not this December, certainly in the next year when the new Congress comes in, to finally fix this problem. And I can say for the National Association of Letter Carriers, we definitely want to be part of the solution. So I appreciate you inviting me here, and thank you. I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Jim, and for underscoring both the partnership and the choices, because I think it's interesting watching these partnerships develop. Because as you mentioned, in the e-commerce era, we wouldn't be able to provide the range of opportunities that people have without the Postal Service. You would not be able to have the phenomenal retail opportunities that have opened up, and particularly, as you mentioned, in terms like prescription drugs. There is no viable alternative to this extensive network. If anybody else tried to replicate it, it would cost more and be less reliable. That's one of the other things that I think is important in terms of the partnership. There are things that make people uneasy. Some of you are probably much more computer literate than I and have never had a problem with online banking. In terms of making a mistake or security issues. But there are some who are a little hesitant. They actually don't want to be hacked. And there's actually a phenomenal record of the integrity of the Postal Service. It's legendary in terms of having less leakage, slippage, problems with employees. When you think of the over a half million permanent and sort of quasi-temporary employees, and think of the record of being able to have high-quality service and the integrity of the service, it's pretty phenomenal. Most of us are not worried about that insurance payment that we drop in the letterbox being hacked. I mean, I'm old, and I've had extraordinary record of success, and it hasn't quite been as much in terms of some of my computer operations. And I've had people trolling my online accounts. I've had problems where there have been accounts shut down. Now, that's not to say that online banking and financial services doesn't have an important role to play, but we ought to respect people who want to do something differently. That ought to be their choice, and this is one that does that. Well, I would like to turn to Daniel Cortez, who's the legislative director for the American Postal Workers Union here in the Portland area, who also comes from a labor family. Parents and wife are all current or retired union members. His grandmother was a Teamster. Great-grandmother was a Teamster. Wow. And has been, we've appreciated your working with us to be able to understand the local dynamics, and appreciate your being here tonight to provide some perspective for your members.
Good evening. Thank you, Congressman Blumenauer, for putting this forum together, and thank all of you for coming. It's an honor and a privilege to be able to speak here this evening. As we have heard, and as many of us are very familiar, the Postal Service is facing numerous challenges. The most significant of these, however, are not coming from a decline in first-class mail volume or from the internet, as many of our detractors would have us believe. Rather, these challenges are coming from a lot closer to home, from a Congress that fails to pass meaningful postal reform, despite valiant efforts by longtime allies like Earl. They come from postal management, who makes decisions to offer premium services to some customers without actually charging a universal price for universal service, or decisions to close mail processing facilities and degrade the service standards to such an extent that our very vote by mail in Oregon could be threatened. But I'm not here to talk about the doom and gloom. I'm not here to talk about those challenges. Instead, I'm here to talk about a few ideas that would be easy to implement that could have a significant and lasting impact on the future of the Postal Service. In 2014, the United States Postal Service, USPS, generated close to $130 million in revenue by processing 5 million passport applications. In a report issued in October of last year, the Office of the Inspector General, or OIG, identified 181 post offices that should expand passport services significantly. Two of those offices are here in Oregon, the Portland office and the Bend office. So far, however, we have not seen significant movement in that direction. This is unfortunate because the Department of State has, the Department of State has told us that the number of passports issued each year in Oregon has increased by 28% in the last 5 years, from 135,000 in 2011 to more than 174,000 in 2015. Despite this increase, however, we have not seen a commensurate increase in the passport acceptance hours at post offices in the metro area. In fact, we have actually seen some reductions. There are 50 post offices and stations within 20 miles of us right now, but only 15 of them offer passport services, and only two of those offer services past 3 p.m. There are 22 offices near us that have window hours open on the weekends, including 8 of those 15 passport offices. Yet there is not a single post office in the Portland metro area that offers passport services on weekends. This problem is magnified when we remember that in order for a child under 16 to get a passport, that child and both parents must be physically present at the time the application is submitted. How much easier would it be on working families across Oregon and across the country to handle some of those things in the evening or on the weekend? We can easily imagine the immediate benefits, and that's just from making a few easy tweaks locally. before implementing the extended recommendations provided by the OIG. This is just one example of the many avenues open to the Postal Service to continue to increase revenue and fulfill its mission of service to the American people. Over the years, the OIG has offered numerous recommendations for adding new services, increasing revenue, and improving and expanding existing services. In talking about the partnership that Earl previously mentioned between labor and management and some of the other stakeholders, earlier this year, the American Postal Workers Union and the USPS formed a Service Enhancement and Innovation Task Force. One of the first services that this task force will be addressing offers solutions to real problems faced by millions of working Americans. The service promises a solution that will benefit them, the workers, and not Wall Street. That service is postal banking. Postal banking is not a new idea. It first came to prominence in 1861 in Great Britain and was wildly successful by any measure. Fast forward to 2016, when 1.5 billion people around the world in 136 countries receive some form of financial service through their local post office. The time has come for us to embrace it here in the U.S. Or, as Earl reminded us, the time has come for us to implement it again. Postal banking was first proposed under Ulysses S. Grant, but then, as now, it faced fierce opposition from the financial sector. It wasn't until 1910, under President Taft, that it was finally signed into law. And from 1911 to 1967, the millions of Americans entrusted their money to the postal savings system. It actually hit a peak in 1947 with nearly $3.4 billion in savings deposits. That's roughly $35 billion in 2016 dollars. $35 billion in savings at the post office. Today, just like at the turn of the century, there are millions of Americans who are financially underserved, working Americans who desperately need financial services that will work for them. Before we can get into what the 21st century version of postal banking might look like, let's take a step back and discuss who we mean by the financially underserved. To quote from an OIG report, "The underserved are a geographically, economically, and demographically diverse group of people who, by choice or circumstance, operate partially or completely outside the traditional banking system. We define underserved as primarily consisting of two main groups, the unbanked, who have no checking or savings account, and the underbanked, who have a bank account but also use at least one non-bank financial service during the year. One in four U.S. households live at least partially outside of the financial mainstream, without bank accounts or using costly services like payday lenders. One in four. One in four households equates to roughly 68 million American adults who are underserved by the current scheme of things. The average underserved household has an annual income of $25,500, and they have to spend nearly 10% of that, almost $200 per month, in check cashing fees, interest on payday loans, or other alternative financial services. Who benefits in this single endless cycle? Certainly not the American worker. 4.1 million of whom are currently paid with payroll cards. Imagine being paid with a payroll card, but you don't have a bank account, so then you end up spending $40 to $50 a month in ATM fees just to access your own money. These exorbitant fees, predatory lending practices, are essentially penalties. They're penalties for not having a bank account, penalties for not being rich, or penalties for living in the wrong zip code. In fact, 59% of the Postal Service's more than 30,000 locations are in zip codes with one or no bank branches. That's not surprising when we realize that just since the recession of 2009, more than 5,000 bank branches have closed nationwide. These closures have created and increased the number of banking deserts across the country, many of which are in rural or minority communities. The Postal Service, by increasing the financial services offered, is uniquely situated to address these and other financial challenges for working Americans. It is worth noting that not only did we have postal banking for more than 50 years, but the United States Postal Service today continues to offer some financial services. The USPS sold more than 97 million money orders in 2014. They offer international money transfers. All postal window clerks are trained and required to comply with the Bank Secrecy Act and other federal financial regulations. The OIG has determined that not only is there a, quote, established presence of financial services, but also that, quote, expanded financial offerings would be in the spirit of the organization's founding mission to support commerce and to serve citizens. That report goes on to say that increased financial services offered by the USPS could result in, and I'm quoting here, the single best opportunity to earn additional revenue. If even 10% of the underserved current of what the underserved currently spend on interest and fees instead went to more affordable offerings from the Postal Service, it could lead to an $8.9 billion in new revenue per year, end quote. $8.9 billion per year. That would solve the pre-funding requirement that's ridiculous anyway. The first steps would be to expand and enhance the services that can be offered under existing regulations and legislation. These could include expanded and enhanced electronic money transfers, payroll check cashing, bill payment to potentially include e-commerce payments, prepaid cards, surcharge-free ATMs, and identity authentication. All of these things, from expanded financial services to expanded passport services, can and should be implemented now. We don't need to wait. Then, while that's going on, with help from leaders like Earl, we can restore service standards, preserve door-to-door delivery, and fully expand postal banking to meet the needs of the financially underserved Americans. I will conclude with apologies to the Inspectors General with a mashup of OIG quotes that kind of seem to flow together. Postal financial services may appeal to many customers who feel abandoned by major financial institutions. Postal organizations have an unmatched ability to reach consumers from diverse backgrounds. A suite of financial services from the Postal Service could be a powerful new tool to help the underserved become more financially secure. By offering non-bank financial services, the Postal Service could fulfill an essential public purpose, increasing the level of financial inclusion in the United States and expanding the number of alternatives for all consumers. Postal financial services could assist underserved families in making steps toward the mainstream financial system, possibly building up savings and eventually embracing offerings from traditional retail banks. Moreover, postal financial services would fit well with the Postal Service's founding mission to serve citizens and support the growth of commerce. The Postal Service is an excellent and in some ways unmatched position to meet these citizens' needs. That would be good for American families, for banks, and for the entire country. I would like to again say thank you to Congressman Blumenauer and to all of you. For more information on postal banking, we have a flyer in the back, or you can visit the website, campaignforpostalbanking.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. Last, but by no means least, we have Kathi Clapp. She has been Oregon State President for National Association of Postal Supervisors. She's just 3 weeks into retirement. Doesn't she already look taller and tanned? She served as an officer for the National Association of Postal Supervisors for over 16 years in a variety of positions, and the bulk of her career was in postal management. We're really pleased to have you here to perhaps share some observations from your perspective.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kathi.
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity to open the conversation. The National Association of Postal Supervisors, if you don't know, we represent postmasters, managers, and supervisors in every level of the Postal Service throughout, in our case, throughout the Portland District, including 986 zip codes. We have approximately 400 members in our local organization, and we represent not only just our members, but the extension of our families. So when you look at postal, what we represent. We, when we come to the table and we talk about postal issues that affect us, it's also our families that are affected. And so that's something that's very important to remember. First, I want to thank you for something that's not on postal reform, but I want to thank you for co-sponsoring House Bill 1198, which extends the MSPB appeal rights to many of our postal management employees. So thank you so much for doing that for us. We appreciate that. As both of the gentlemen who have spoken have addressed the need for changes in the Postal Service, and we know that that's necessary. We no longer are conducting business the way we did when I entered the Postal Service in 1981. The Post Office has started making a return to profitability. If you've looked at the business that we're conducting now, our parcel business has increased substantially. And that appears to be where we're heading for the future. E-commerce and the internet has actually offered us an opportunity to boost our package revenue. And it means that actually we're a net positive when we look at the business that we've been generating over the internet. One thing that I think is important to note is that that's also extended our delivery. We, in many locations, are now delivering 7 days a week and not 6 days a week. And that's something that we need to explore further. I know that in the office that I was just the postmaster in, we had the largest amount of Amazon delivery on Sunday in the entire state of Oregon. And there's an opportunity there possibly to expand more business on Sundays and look at other ways that we can increase revenue by the fact that we're already open and we have the building open and we're paying to be in business on that day. The Post Office is one of the most trusted and important government agencies, as we all know. And everybody in this room is part of the reason for that. I think it's really a good opportunity to open conversation amongst the people who are actually doing the work every day. And that includes all the employees of the Postal Service, whether we're management or whether we're craft employees. We all have a common goal. And the common goal is that we retain the viability of this agency and we retain the Americans' trust in us doing that business. We're required by law to perform for the American public that which they cannot do for themselves. That's Title 39, and it requires us to offer a universal service. And we want to do that with the best possible service that we can give our customers. One of the things that has occurred through the increased use of the internet is the visibility of our performance to our customers. As most of you know, you can go online now and you can track. You have live tracking of what's occurring with your piece of mail or your parcel. We need to continue to offer that service to our customers because that's what they expect out of us. They expect to know what's happening with their mail. There's more and more opportunity for us to track performance of our employees and of our services that we're offering. So that's something that has changed with our business. I do appreciate, though, the opportunity that we can look forward together. This is not just about one organization or another or our individual interests. There is always going to be things that we do not agree on, but there certainly is one thing that we agree on, and that's the future of the Postal Service. So I do appreciate you allowing me to come in and discuss that with everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathi. I do appreciate your joining us and the perspective about the partnership that's here. I think there's a lot of false conflict that is portrayed because I have been struck by how much there is a willingness to be able to innovate and partner in both in terms of the postal organizations, people who are perceived as being, quote, competitors, but there's a lot of common interest. And then as Daniel mentioned, there are ways to get more value out of the existing system. I mean, I think of the cost of predatory lending in this country and being able to take advantage of these opportunities from coast to coast for people to have something that's safe and secure, that's not predatory, that where the profit accrues to the public, I think is a very powerful concept. And your notion about what would happen in terms of being a little more aggressive about providing the services for passport, issuing passports. We're in a world where that passport is getting more important. More people are traveling. If we don't come in compliance with our driver's licenses in Oregon, the passport is going to be absolutely essential. And not that I think we'll screw it up, but it'd be nice to have as a backup. But an opportunity to generate revenue, provide greater convenience, and at virtually no cost. Instead, as you say, offset costs that are there. We have the facilities 365 days a year. We have a skilled workforce. We have a network. And I appreciate your helping us just sort of flesh out a little bit what would be possible going forward if we do it right. We thought we would take a few minutes. You've got some experts. We have some experts here in the audience for people who either wanted to make some comments or ask the experts a question. And I think we have a microphone there. So we would ask that you would go to the microphone, identify yourself, Jamie. Because there may be somebody watching at home who doesn't know who you are, but identify yourself and speak into the microphone so that it can be picked up by our friends with cable access.
Thank you, Earl. I'm Jamie Partridge. I'm a retired letter carrier and an organizer with Communities and Postal Workers United. A number of us from Portland are here tonight, and we have two main concerns that we wanted to bring forward, particularly to you. But to the body. One is defending door-to-door delivery, and the other is saving our downtown postal service. On the issue of the door-to-door delivery, Jim Sauber mentioned that this bill that's possibly going through the lame duck session of Congress, H.R. 5714, contains a poison pill, Section 202, which would eliminate at-the-door delivery for businesses and residential customers. And despite the fact that a majority of the House of Representatives, including yourself, have signed on as co-sponsors to a bill that would preserve, that has the sense of Congress that that door-to-door delivery should be preserved, that's H.R. House Resolution 28, a bipartisan unanimous vote of the committee, the Oversight Committee that voted for a due pass recommendation, this Postal Reform Act of 2016, including folks that signed on to this resolution for preserving at-the-door delivery, voted a bill to the floor that would eliminate at-the-door delivery. So we're really concerned that this section not stay in the bill, and would call on you and colleagues to try to amend to that bill to take that section out. Secondly, just real quickly, the Postal Service, the main post office downtown, is going to be demolished within 18 months and replaced within. There's an agreement between the City of Portland and the Postal Service to replace the retail facility with another unit within seven blocks, and we're concerned that it provides service as good or better as the service that's provided by the retail unit now. It's the best post office in the city. I mean, it's got early hours, late closing, 24-hour lobby. It's got the only general delivery in the city. It's got passport applications, all this. We have in our packet, for those of you who got these packets, some of you signed on to a letter along with Representative Bonamici calling on postal management to provide us a facility that is comparable, but also to call for a public hearing so that those of us here can voice our opinion about what we think what we deserve in postal service downtown. And actually, I was hoping there was going to be a management representative here today so that I could give them the 1,000 signatures that we've collected on our petition with those demands. But nobody here. No, she's not. She's retired. She doesn't work for the Postal Service anymore. But so those are our two concerns. Thank you.
Thank you. You raise, I think, a very important point. When we talk about the Postal Service providing infrastructure, having a high quality central city postal facility is important for commerce. I mean, these are, we've seen some of that erode in the central city. With the university station, it does deeply concern me, because this is something that is part of the attractiveness of downtown Portland for business and people who live there conducting business. So I really appreciate your making the point. I think it would be valuable to be able to have a public expression of that, like a hearing, as you say. And in part, one of the reasons I wanted to have this conversation now, before we go into a lame duck session, is that I think these are the type of conversations we need to have around the country. When I find that people focus on these issues, they are concerned, and they would support reasonable alternatives. The problem is, this is a conversation, except for some of you working in this room, it's below the radar. It's below the radar. And I'm hopeful that we have forums like this, but there are other ways, the hearing in downtown Portland, that there's a way to elevate the stakes. What is at stake for not just the Postal Service, but for the public? And I deeply appreciate your raising those two items.
Thank you, Congressman. James Cook, I'm a retired letter carrier, past president of Branch 82 Letter Carriers Local, and currently legislative liaison. And thus, I want to thank you for the term saving U.S. Postal Service, because we've been under attack for decades. They've been chipping away. At one time, we created express mail, overnight delivery, and the private delivery statutes were loosened so that FedEx and others could be created. But we still survived decades later, and I thank the employees of the Postal Service for that primarily. Two issues I'd like to bring up, sir. One is, as a letter carrier and going door to door, you get to know who is on your route. You watch out for those people. In some cases, you feel like family after a number of years. We care about our communities, wherever they are in this country. And when we lose, if we should lose door-to-door delivery, which is Section 202 of H.R. 5714, and we'd appreciate that being amended to remove that completely, if we lose that, we lose the eyes and ears of the nation, basically, because when you talk about first responders, you have, of course, the police force. You have the firefighters. But we're the letter carriers. We're there day in and day out. And if there's an earthquake, which we're expecting a 9.0 in this community, we would know where the vulnerable people are, potentially. And we only let law enforcement know that now. And that's what we would do then. But we would have the knowledge. The second point I'd like to make is that we have an opportunity for innovation, as you know, in many ways. But one is in renewable energy. We have so many vehicles in this country that rely on fossil fuels. And if we could convert those vehicles to electric vehicles based on renewable sources of energy that were at each post office, if we could have post offices being community solar panels, et cetera, if we could just allow the Postal Service to be innovative in the area of renewable resources, we could once again pioneer, as we've done, as you mentioned, railroad industry, the airline industry. We have funded the pioneering of those industries as a postal agency. So thank you for this forum. Thank you for and if there are any comments, thank you.
I think that's a great observation. There are over 200,000 postal vehicles, and most of them tend to be pretty short radius around the postal state, at least so far. thinking about combining what you were talking about in terms of making this part of a national priority for more green energy. But if we had a bid to replace 25,000 of those vehicles every year with state-of-the-art electrical vehicles, what a way to jumpstart the electrical vehicle industry. And it would, of course, be cleaner and ultimately cheaper and have huge economic impact. And I think that's a very important point that you raise. Now, your point about the community connection, I was just introduced this evening to Walter Groeschel, who is the Willie, who is the jack of diamonds in the PAC that the area that he serves in Northeast Portland has some community heroes. And it's just sort of an expression of that connection and that support and that recognition. And I would be proud to be a jack of diamonds. But it is a part of that opportunity we have to keep connected, to have eyes on the street. There are any number of charitable activities that postal workers have done, food drives. I mean, it really is a remarkable resource. But that personal connection, not just in time of crisis, but day in and day out, looking out for people and being part of that community fabric, I think is really important and doesn't get the attention that it deserves. But maybe our panelists would.
I just had one comment on the issue of door-to-door delivery. I think the questioners raised, you know, the really important issues. In the context of the lobbying we've done on this bill, we've also emphasized that it doesn't really particularly make a lot of business sense. The way the bill is drafted now, it basically makes the Postal Service identify business deliveries that they could convert to cluster box or curb line delivery. But taking letter carriers out of the offices of businesses really doesn't make any sense at all, because those are not just deliveries, those are also pickups. This is a revenue opportunity for us. And so and breaking the relationship that letter carriers have with local businesses, especially small businesses, is a way to lose revenue. And so we think that's just a mistake in a way of saving money. It's very short term. In addition, the value of direct mail, what people don't realize is direct mail is still one of the best, most effective ways for small and medium-sized businesses to advertise. It's one of the most cost-effective ways to advertise and most effective way in general. So it's been it declined a bit during the recession, but has bounced back. And the value of direct mail is really valuable in that when people want to look at it, it's on their kitchen table, and it's where, you know, they figure out when they want to look at it, when they want to plan their shopping, especially for local merchants. And going to centralized delivery reduces the value of that direct mail. And it will be less valuable to mailers and to advertisers, because they know it's just, if you're at a cluster box, it tends to get thrown away and not looked at. Whereas if you bring it home, it's there when you want to use it. And so, again, we don't think that makes much business sense. Beyond all the sort of discrimination issues that involve, if you're a disabled American or an elderly person, particularly where I grew up in Detroit, you know, in the wintertime, it's very icy and dangerous to put cluster boxes out in the neighborhoods for the elderly to have to go retrieve their mail. And so it's really, we don't think this is the right approach, and that's why we're working so hard to get rid of it.
It's a great point. And you're underscoring the value of the relationship every day. Mm-hmm. I mean, we see this with a number of businesses. I mean, utilities in their monthly bills have refined it to an art form in terms of communications with the customer. Having that connection as an opportunity to enhance the service, provide other opportunities to close the link, I think is something that ought to be explored very carefully before we're talking about eliminating it or reducing it, undercutting it.
Jim Falvey, I'm the president, Branch 82, a 36-year postal employee. And thanks, Earl, to you and your staff for putting this together. I know we started working on this way back in the summer. Weather was a little bit different then. And thank you to the panel for being here, but especially Jim, because he came the furthest from Washington, not state, D.C. And so we appreciate that. But what I want to talk about is House Resolution 54, which, Earl, you're a co-sponsor on, and we appreciate that. You know, it involves a sense of the House that the Postal Service has to restore the service standards back to July of 2012, which was prior to the institution of the rationalization plan, most ill-named plan ever to call it rational. But anyway, phase one, they closed 48 mail processing facilities in 2012 and then another 92 in 2013. And that was started by Postmaster Generals Potter and Donahue. They took us down that path. Now, in fairness to Postmaster General Brennan, I don't think she shares that same philosophy. However, what did concern me was some testimony that she had given late last year, in which she said, in the event that House Resolution 54 becomes law, she'll be unable to reopen those processing plants. She'll be unable to restore those other offices that were closed. And quite frankly, if we don't restore those processing plants, plus phase two, which will involve another 96 plants to be closed, is only on a moratorium. The plan still exists, and it could still come to plan, and we would lose more processing facilities. And as we lose these processing facilities, the ability of the letter carrier to show up with the mail when the person who is expecting it is drastically affected. And that's really where the confidence is lost at. Because, you know, it's kind of like a national joke. Hey, I went to the post office, there was a long line, right? I mean, and quite frankly, management's been trying to deal with that the last few years. But when people say to the mailman or the mail to the letter carrier, when they say, hey, I've been expecting this letter for days now. They told me they sent it, and I haven't gotten it. That's usually now attributed to the fact that it just takes longer to process the mail. And so I guess it's kind of like a two-part question is, number one, if House Resolution 54 becomes statute and they say you must return to the standard set that we had in July of 2012, will the Postal Service be able to reopen those plants? Because it's my understanding that a lot of the equipment that was used in those plants was destroyed. And that is, and in Postmaster General Brennan's testimony, if I recall correctly, she said that was the major obstacle, was that they no longer have the equipment that was in those plants. So if anybody could give us any kind of insight on if we'd ever be able to get back to quote unquote, you know, two-day delivery in a place like Portland, or are we just stuck with this reduced standard for the rest of the existence of the Postal Service?
Any of our experts have an opinion on this?
Lots of opinions. I receive mail at my duty station from that's generated in the building where the main processing center is in downtown Portland. It comes from one post office and postal facility to another. It takes 3 or 4 days for that first class mail to get to me, and that's not coming to my house. It was never picked up by someone at another business or residence. It's generated in the Postal Service going to a post office, and it can take 3 to 4 days. I hear Jim's point, absolutely. In Oregon, they've already closed Sunset Processing Center here in Portland. They closed Salem. They were threatening to close Eugene. They gutted most of Bend. They pulled the processing out of Pendleton. And it's, like you said, there's the moratorium, but some of those buildings across the country are gone. They've closed down the processing center, gotten rid of the equipment. Even if they've just moved it or mothballed it, the building itself is no longer owned by the Postal Service. So there's going to have to be a massive effort to bring that back online. And it feels like that was all part of the plan. the degradation of service standards that allowed those offices to close, and then, oh, well, sure, we'd love to be able to offer that service again, but we can't. And so it's going to be imperative that the how become part of become part of the conversation when that becomes law. But we cannot allow the Postal Service thinking that they can't implement the legislation to prevent the legislation from passing. If we can get that passed, that the service standards must be restored to the July of 2012 levels, then they'll find a way. They found a way to not deliver mail quickly. They can find a way to go back to what they did for since the beginning of the Postal Service, that mail must move. We don't leave mail sitting overnight in buildings. We move the mail. As clerks, we get it to the carriers. The carriers get it to the customer. That's the cycle. That's the way that we need to continue doing it.
Kathi, do you have any observations?
To address your question, Jim, I'm not familiar with what has occurred with all the equipment that has been taken out of the mail processing facilities. I assume, and I'm not here to speak on behalf of the agency, and I want to make sure that I clarify that I am not speaking on behalf of the agency.
Understood.
However, I believe that the new processing equipment should be able to process more mail in a more efficient manner, and that is the plans for the future, particularly for the Portland District when they move all the plants, consolidate the plants into the one facility. But in response to what happened to the other equipment, I know that they've moved a lot of the equipment throughout the nation to facilities that didn't have that type of upgraded equipment. To reopen those facilities, though, I don't have an answer for you. I don't know that the Postal Service has the capability of doing that or they have the resources to do that. So that's actually a very, very good question.
Jim, you have any?
Yeah, I mean, this is the damage I think that was done with the speed with which that restructuring plan was done, there may be some permanent damage. Obviously, you can reopen the plants if you have the resources, and that would be the key. Going forward, we're going to have a review starting in December on the rate setting process. Right now, for the last 10 years, we've been operating under rates have not been able to go up more than the consumer price index. As you all know, there's virtually been no inflation, and at least measured by the CPI. So that doesn't provide a lot of resources for investment. And so that's why it's so important to have a comprehensive reform that looks at ways to innovate and grow. I think Daniel's presentation on postal banking was excellent, that could provide the kind of investment resources to not only, you know, improve the service over time, but also replace all our vehicles and have an energy efficient fleet. So it's really important to get an overall comprehensive package done so that we can get the Postal Service on a different track going forward so we can grow for the future.
Well, it is just a little frustrating as the delegation met with the Postal Service, the senators, and several of us in the House, trying to understand the logic of shutting down some of these key facilities. And then, you know, the letter from Pendleton has to come to Portland before it goes back to Pendleton. And I had my head just sort of scratching here a little bit, trying to really understand why this is, in the long run, going to be overall more effective than having some key facilities around the country.
Just one other comment, and just, you know, I'm not here to be the defense attorney for the prior postmaster generals, but this is the damage of the pre-funding policy.
No.
I mean, this when, no. You know, the Postal Service had to use up every dime of their borrowing authority to pay for pre-funding, which is just insane. We're actually putting there's now $50 billion sitting in this retiree health fund. That's enough for 25 or 30 years of future retiree health benefits. And we used all our borrowing authority to do that in the middle of the worst recession in 80 years. And rational companies, that's not how you use your, you know, scarce resources. Some of that could have been used for maintaining quality service and investing in a new fleet and improve efficiencies. And instead, it all went for this irrational policy. So it's not that I don't think postal management would have come to that. That would not have been their set of priorities had it not been for the legislation that was passed in 2006 with that pre-funding mandate.
Understood. And again, one of, I think, 142nd on the list of 500 largest businesses in the world, they all have capital budgets. They all have borrowing authority. When you've got tens of billions of dollars going back and forth and you have over 30,000 facilities, there is tremendous demand for ongoing capital of any enterprise. And to just somehow defy the logic of the organizational integrity for any large organization, whether it's public or private, I find it embarrassing. And it creates sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Mm-hmm. Create an artificial deficit, have draconian budget cuts, erode service levels, which in turn are used to justify further ratcheting down, because of course it doesn't work very well. And it's just, I find it depressing and disingenuous. But I'm talking too much.
My name is Richard Strom. I'm from Medford, Oregon, and recently retired letter carrier. And I'll try to make this coherent. I really didn't plan on saying much, but kind of got into it. I notice a theme here and a real will, especially in this room, to kind of reverse the trend that the Postal Service is taking. And I really encourage you to really focus on what's happening in downtown Portland. I hope it doesn't turn out like downtown Medford, where a number of years ago we sold the old post office for much less than it was worth, moved the window counters into a former car dealership, and the last time I was in there, the window clerk handed me my receipt at the end of the transaction. He said, "See that code at the bottom? Be sure and scan that barcode. Take the survey. Tell them we need a bigger post office." And I said, "Yeah, I sure will," as I'm kind of elbowing my way out the door through the line that is almost always going out the door down there. But really, I kind of inspired to stand up here, and I hope it's okay to say something in your district. I know I'm not from here, but something the congressman said kind of inspired me. I drove up here today on a very wet I-5, and I like driving around Oregon. I especially like driving east of the Cascades. There's some beautiful country over there. You go through Klamath Falls, Jordan Valley, lots of little bitty towns there, too. Riley, Burns, Juntura, Christmas Valley, you all been there? You drive along the high desert and you come to one of these, you notice a few buildings and you come to one of these intersections. And one thing you always notice, because it's open there, an American flag, U.S. flag, standing up on a pole somewhere. And below that flag is the post office, United States Post Office. And a few years ago, I know there was a real push to close a lot of those little post offices, the ones that weren't making money, they said didn't deserve to continue to exist because they weren't bringing in revenue. Well, that's not really the way a universal mandate with uniform prices is supposed to work. I mean, Portland's supposed to make money to support the office in Christmas Valley. And I just want to, you know, ask again if there's any other ideas, because the things like postal banking, expanding passport services, any of those things you do here affects the whole system. You know, this is all Portland district, but it's really a United States Postal Service. It's nationwide. And, you know, anything that will keep those little offices open will help preserve the identities of those small towns. Thanks.
Boy, that's a very, I think, powerful statement, Richard, in terms of a universal system. Some of those smaller operations simply aren't self-supporting. Well, that's also the case with lots of other government services that we provide to rural and small town America. We provide a subsidy because they're part of an integrated system and they deserve a certain level of fire protection or ambulance service, police protection. Being able to appreciate that we don't close all small schools in Oregon because they're more expensive on a per student basis, say. I think we've made decisions that we will provide certain levels of service because people, public health, safety, require it and demand it. And there are other benefits that we get from having services in rural and small town Oregon, because we're all in this together. And you, I think you make a very, very important point. And it's entirely appropriate, I think, that if there is a surplus in some of the metropolitan areas, that it can be shared to be able to maintain quality service that connects people. Because much of the profit of some of the activities in the metropolitan areas will be lost if there isn't universal service. There's money made by people who provide direct mail service or pharmaceuticals or things that are accomplished through the online shopping opportunities. So if you didn't have that universal service, it would cut down on some of the profitability of some of the enterprises in the big cities, it seems to me. Great point. And it's okay if you are out of district. You're welcome. it's the thought that counts.
Hi, my name is John Schweibert. I'm active in Communities and Postal Workers United. I'm a retired United Methodist minister, so I feel like because I've had no direct connection with the Postal Service as an employee, I really do represent the community and the public interest in the Postal Service. One of the deep concerns I have is, as I've been working with Communities and Postal Workers United, we have made numerous attempts to get actual conversations with managers in the Portland area. And we have been totally unsuccessful in doing that. Sometimes the excuse has been, in letters that we've got that said they can't meet with us, is that they only meet with labor. They're not required to meet with the public. And so they will save the meetings for those times when they have to meet in negotiation with organized labor. Some of us object vehemently to that. We feel like one of the mistakes that the Postal Service is making is not caring more about what the public has to say. And we've had some serious issues, including the fact that there is reason to believe that there has been actual fraud related to postal trucking in the Portland area. And we would like to present a material about that, but the Postal Service management locally does not want to hear about it. So that's a concern. Maybe you'd say it's a complaint.
Okay.
We'd like to know more about how we could change that.
Thank you. And Willie, do you want the last word? We're bumping up here against the witching hour. Welcome.
Thank you, Congressman. Sure. Thank you.
Jack of Diamonds.
Sure, that works. Willie Groeschel. I'm a letter carrier up in Northeast Portland, Alberta Arts District. I'm also the Oregon State Association Vice President. I wanted to stand up and remind everybody, I'm glad to see so much discussion on moving forward and preserving this. And I want to remind everybody one of the real important reasons to preserve the Postal Service. There's one thing that I deliver every single day of the week, no matter what. Besides a smile. It's prescription medication from the VA to veterans, young and old. The other side of this equation as well is that the Postal Service employs more veterans than almost any other agency in the entire country. And it provides these brave young women and men that risk everything because they care about this country, because they care about who we are, an opportunity to come back to their community after they've been overseas, after they've been through unspeakable things. and it gives them an avenue to be able to have employment and continue to serve their country and serve their neighborhoods. I have seen firsthand young women and men come back and be able to get jobs at the Postal Service and be able to develop connections within their community, and seeing that help them transition to a civilian life, but still have that life of service. So I just want to remind you how vitally important the Postal Service is, not only for the commerce and all that other stuff, but how important it is just for the very fabric of this country and how much it serves the people that serve us and have sacrificed everything on our behalf. And to throw that away for draconian cuts because of these terrible things that have been done to the post office would just be a crime, an absolute crime. So I just wanted to remind everybody of that aspect of it. So, and thank you so much for giving us this opportunity, Congressman. This is very kind of you. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's an appropriate last word, but it's not the last word. I hope that we'll be able to continue to think about ways to expand the conversation in the community to more people who take the Postal Service for granted. I'm hopeful that we'll be able to explore partnerships and changes. I'm hopeful that some of the things that sound like they're a little out there, like postal savings, it might be an opportunity to really think through the implications of that. I think universal vote by mail ought to be a crusade for everybody who cares about democracy, not just the Postal Service. This, I think, is absolutely the best way to guarantee the integrity of the ballot box that we don't have anymore. It's the mailbox. And because of some of these service standard erosion, now there's questions about whether the mail-in ballot gets in on time. This needs to be a priority. Things, as you described with the passport, ought to be a no-brainer. It's already there, thank you very much. It is within the scope of the post office duties. There is a major public need, and it will make money, not cost money. I don't know exactly what I'm missing on this. But maybe there will be an opportunity as we go forward to pick a couple of these things, like mail-in ballot and deal with the passport, to start changing the discussion, broadening it, being able to have people appreciate what's there, and then the possibility going forward. I am hopeful with your efforts that we will not have goofy decisions in the lame duck session. That's where we got the stupid pre-funding anyway. We got stuff jammed through in 2006, was it? Never really got the widespread attention that it needed, and it's had a whole host of very negative consequences. This helps me to hear again your thoughts, and I truly hope that we can have conversations like this in every community across the country, having local people come together, making the case, spreading the word, using media to be able to expand it so that we get back to where we need to be. But thank you for your time this afternoon and into the evening. Thanks to our panelists. Jim, really appreciate you coming all the way from Washington, D.C. Daniel, great presentation. And Kathi, thanks for slipping out of retirement to be able to share this time with us. Thank you very much.